Jane has just left work and is in the supermarket doing her weekly shopping. She's got a lot of things on her mind and has been rushing around, throwing all the items she needs into the shopping cart. While checking the price on a can of goods, she notices something strange. Her heart has suddenly begun to beat hard, so hard in fact that it is pulsating in her throat. This startles her, and then she notices how her arm begins to shake with a pins and needles sensation. This is the first time anything like this has ever happened to her. She is confused and starting to get really scared. Something must be wrong, she thinks, and begins to mentally list all the possible things it could be. Is it the start of a heart attack? Is it an allergic reaction to something she ate? Her stomach and chest muscles feel really tense and her breathing becomes faster and more shallow. She glances around at the people near her, and as she does so, she feels lightheaded and dizzy. The confusion and fear she feels is sending her into a panic. The sensations in her body intensify, and she is convinced something awful is about to happen. She feels a need to get outside and leaves her shopping cart full of goods behind as she walks slowly towards the exit. As soon as she is outside in the cool air, she feels a slight sense of relief and more in control as the physical sensations are losing momentum. Although she is calming down, she is still in shock and her body is shaking. It feels as if someone had just held a gun to her head. She has never felt so terrified and out of control in all her life. She calls her husband at work and tells him what happened and asks if he would meet her so they can go to the hospital together. A few hours later, Jane is lying on the hospital bed waiting for the results of the medical tests she has completed. The doctor arrives and tells her they cannot find anything physically wrong with her and that it was most likely a panic attack. This is relieving yet confusing at the same time. A panic attack, she thinks. She remembers an aunt that experienced panic attacks, but never really understood what that meant and certainly never imagined it felt as scary as what she just went through. Glad that nothing is physically wrong, she checks out of the hospital and goes home. Within minutes of lying on the bed, she falls fast asleep. On waking the following day, Jane immediately begins to go over the ordeal in her mind. It all seems like a surreal dream. By lunchtime, she is already second-guessing the medical tests and convinces herself that something was missed and that there must be something more serious than anxiety involved. Days pass and she cannot stop thinking about what happened in the supermarket. She still feels shaken by the experience and lives in fear that it might strike her again at any moment. For the first time in her life, she does not feel safe leaving her home.
Letting my emotions run loose, they're going to call the police and have me committed or something.
I could barely leave the house. I couldn't go two blocks without getting a panic attack. When I panic, what I feel is literally like I am inches from death.
I think the time has come to do that. Is that all right with you?
Well, I have no other choice than that, so it's all right with me.
Do you think you can do it?
I've been wanting to do it.
You want to address this demon that's been hanging over you?
Yes, I was going to take it one step at a time, but I guess jumping all at once wouldn't hurt.
It's genuine, complete, and total fear.
the feeling like something absolutely terrible was going to happen at any given second.
We'll come back on 14th Street.
Union Square.
Union Square, so that we can go under the tunnel.
Okay.
And I know that's going to be hard for you, but that's something we have to do.
I'm actually doing all right.
So far, so good.
Yeah. That, yeah.
I love you too.
What I've been told is that what I'm feeling is like a hypersensitivity to my own body's function. It's my heartbeat, my breathing might get funny, and I tend to twitch my neck. Case scenario, some of the dumbest stuff in the galaxy. I just don't think. It sounds just a bunch of different stuff. Like, over the last couple of years, it escalated to the point of I just not wanting to go anywhere. I mean, I love driving stuff, I love going places.
Oh, for people that have them, they're usually tremendously frightening to the point that they can either cause them to seek medical attention or they can make a change in their lives. Now, panic attacks, especially recurrent ones, are things that people don't understand. They don't understand what's going on with them, so they become fearful. So your brain searches the menu of options, if you will, just like on a computer, to try to figure out, why am I feeling like this? Well, you look around and you find out, well, where am I? Well, I'm in my car, or I'm in a shopping mall, or I'm in a movie theater, or I'm in a crowded church or something. And so our brain tells us, aha, that's what's causing it. It's the car, or it's the crowded shopping mall, or it's the movie theater, or wherever we are. And then what happens often is people with panic attacks that are recurrent will begin to avoid those places. That's a process called agoraphobia, technically a fear of open spaces. But it generally is the place where the panic attack occurs. And people with panic disorder will avoid those places where panic attacks have occurred. And that then generalizes. The worst case I've ever seen is somebody who couldn't leave their bedroom. It got worse and worse. It started off with a crowded shopping mall, and then it got to the point they couldn't leave their home, and then it got to the point they couldn't leave their bedroom. So this can have devastating consequences. One of the people I know well, who's now a therapist, who specializes in treating panic disorder, was one of the top salesmen regionally for one of the bigger companies in the country. He flew 250,000 air miles a year, had his first panic attack on an airplane, and he couldn't fly anymore after the second one. The first one he wrote off, well, I don't know what that was, but hopefully that'll never happen again. Well, when the second one happened on an airplane, he couldn't fly anymore. If he couldn't fly, he couldn't sell. If he couldn't sell, he lost his job, and that's what happened. In his treatment, he became so enamored with the treatment process at how well he had done that he himself went back, got his master's degree, and now specializes in treating people with panic disorder. An interesting agoraphobia side of that story was, for whatever reason, this guy got to the point that he could only travel 7 miles from his home. Now, I don't know why 7 miles. There was probably some psychological significance to that. But he met a woman who lived 14 miles away. And interestingly, they would have to meet in the middle. He couldn't exceed that 7-mile limit, and then they could get together for their dates or whatever they had. This man is wonderful now in treating people with this disorder, I think because he really understands panic disorder.
Hi, I'm Dr. Greg Kaysan for WebbyHealth.com. Did you ever have an eccentric aunt who wouldn't leave the house? You always had to visit her and she would never go anywhere else? Well, maybe she just wasn't eccentric. She may have suffered from a debilitating anxiety disorder known as panic disorder with agoraphobia. Now, in this disorder, people experience sudden and unexpected panic attacks where they fear they're either going to go crazy or completely lose control or even die. Those with panic experience an intense fear or discomfort that comes on quickly. And during the panic, the person experiences several things that may include a pounding heart, sweating, shortness of breath, nausea, dizziness, and fears of going crazy or dying. Because they never know when one of these attacks might happen, they experience agoraphobia, which is fear and avoidance of situations that they consider unsafe. Now, it's unsafe because they may have another panic attack and because it may be difficult or embarrassing to escape or maybe get to a hospital. In the most severe cases, those with agoraphobia become totally unable to leave their house for years on end. In this condition, if you have unexpected panic attacks and are afraid that you may have another one, you want to be in a safe place or at least with a safe person who knows what you're experiencing. Typical situations that may be avoided are normal situations for most of us, like restaurants, waiting in line, crowds, buses, subways, planes, elevators, tunnels, and any number of other situations where escape might be difficult or embarrassing. Now, avoiding these situations is simply one way to cope with unexpected panic attacks, but the avoidance becomes a self-imposed prison. Some people with this disorder don't actually avoid agoraphobic situations. These are the people that just endure them with intense dread. Now, it's difficult to say how many people have agoraphobia, but at any one time, approximately 1/3 of those with panic disorder are thought to go on to develop agoraphobia. Of those, 75% are women, but this number is also in question as many men may deny their fear and use alcohol or drugs to cover up. Like other anxiety disorders, there are drug treatments that include anti-anxiety and antidepressant medications that may be helpful. Psychological treatment, especially cognitive behavioral therapy, has proven to be quite effective in treating agoraphobic avoidance and panic disorder. This type of treatment has been helpful in reducing anxiety, panic, agoraphobic avoidance in nearly 70% of patients. Now, if you would like information about this or other anxiety disorders, visit the Anxiety Disorders Association of America website at www.adaa.org. If you would like more information about me, you may go to my website at www.drgreg.com. I'm Dr. Greg Kaysom for webbyhealth.com. Thank you for watching.
Many people don't know that their disorder is real and highly responsive to treatment. Some are afraid or embarrassed to tell anyone, including their doctors and loved ones, about what they experience for fear of being considered a hypochondriac. Instead, they suffer in silence, distancing themselves from friends, family, and others who could be helpful or supportive.